Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Mark Callahan, candidate for U.S. Representative District 5. Hi, Mark. Nice
to see
Mark.
You. Hi, Mark. How are you doing?
Very good. I've interviewed you before when you were running for Senate, so welcome back.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and your background and why you're running for U.S. Representative.
Well, I'm a father of two beautiful teenage daughters. I have the gray hair to prove it up here, but I'm a father. I'm an average American, and I love our country. And it got to the point for me where I just could not sit on the couch, watch TV, and complain anymore. For one, the TV doesn't really yell back at you,
right.
But I'm the type of person, I'm a man of action, I have to get out there and do something. And I have a background in troubleshooting. I'm a computer guy by trade, so I'm an IT guy by trade. Been doing work, computer work for about 18 years. And so I kind of have that troubleshooter mindset, and I like to solve problems. I put together puzzles when I was younger on the kitchen table myself, and it's just the way my mind works. So if I can get out there and use that skill, go back there to Congress and actually use that skill to solve some problems that we're facing, I'm going to go ahead and do it.
So tell us about your top two or three priorities and some of those problems that you'd like to solve.
Well, my top two or three priorities, I see immigration as a real issue in our country. Trump mentioned this when he was running for office as well. I'm actually on the board for Oregonians for Immigration Reform. And so right now we're circulating a petition called IP22 to stop Oregon from being a sanctuary state. So the way I see immigration is this. If you're going to be here, you need to be here legally. And I actually support, I think the wall on the southern border, I support that, yes. But I think that's a reaction to people not being here legally. They are here illegally. They're illegal aliens. And the way I see, I love this country so much. I want to protect and guide the path of the country, yes, but we also need people to follow the law. You can't just pick and choose which laws you want to follow if you're going to be an American and you want to be a U.S. citizen. So that's my biggest issue right now that I'm talking about on the campaign trail. I know you mentioned a couple years ago I actually ran for U.S. Senate against the current seated senator that's been in there for about 37 years.
Mm-hmm.
I ran statewide in that race, and I got a lot of good name recognition. I got about 651,000 votes statewide. So statewide includes Congressional District 5. And so my team and I took a look at the numbers statewide, the 651,000,
right.
And CD5 is a subset of those numbers. We compared those with Colin Willis's numbers, who was the Republican that ran against Kurt Schrader in 2016, as well as Kurt Schrader's numbers, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell you, Marge, it's very, very exciting. We're within a few thousand of actually winning and turning District 5 and being represented by a Republican.
Okay. So do you feel that your views match up with your constituents in Oregon?
I think they do. Yeah, I've traveling all over the district. It's very drivable. The district covers Marion County, Polk County, Clackamas County, Lincoln and Tillamook counties on the coast. The coast is beautiful, by the way.
I know.
when it's not raining, but
yes.
It's still beautiful, though.
Yes.
But I've been talking to voters out there, giving speeches. As I said, I can stand up in front of a room, 50 to 100 people, and give a speech, but I actually value the one-on-one before and after the speech, because that's when I get to know people. I'm a very sociable guy. I'm a very personable guy, and I think the reason why I run is because I like talking to people, and I just want to solve problems. I want to get back there and solve some problems. So,
well, right now, a lot of people's problems are in their pocketbook,
yep.
And they care about economic issues.
Mm-hmm.
And there was just a recent tax reform legislation that was passed, and some Oregonians are worried that there's going to be a negative effect here in Oregon. And also, I think the recent tariffs that have been negotiated may impact Oregon farmers. So what are your views on that?
Well, I think are you referring to the SALT deductions,
yes.
Right? Okay, yeah, the state and local income tax deductions
that were basically
left out of the tax reform or tax cuts plan that was recently signed into law by President Trump. I actually support the tax cuts that were recently signed into law. I think it's a great first step. I'm a limited government guy myself. And I feel that it's a good first step in the right direction, but I think more can be done. For example, the individual income tax cuts, if we can make those beyond the 10-year mark, mm-hmm. I think that would be another good first step. I'm a limited government guy. I actually support and propose legislation for a flat tax. I was really supporting a flat tax when I was running for U.S. Senate a couple years ago. But anything that we can do to limit government, to limit the heavy hand of government, give people more freedom, because more freedom gets from less government. Less government equals more freedom, basically.
Okay. I know that infrastructure is a key issue, mm-hmm. Of the current administration. Mm-hmm. Right now, Oregon has a lot of transportation needs, fixing of roads, a yep. lot of backlog on maintenance. With limited government and lowered taxes, how are we going to pay for those things?
I think we can be more efficient. Honestly, I think government can be more efficient. If we can farm some of it out to the private sector is in a competitive market. We live in a capitalist marketplace. And if we can farm some of that out to the private sector instead of the cronyism that you commonly hear about in government happening, I think we're going to do well. If we can farm that out to the private sector, or some of that out to the private sector, we can have multiple private sector businesses competing against each other. It's going to do best for the taxpayers. I mean, the invisible hand of the marketplace, free market, is the best way to go in that circumstance.
Okay. Some of those things can't be privatized, such as education. And the funding of education is always an issue. Mm-hmm. It's one of the biggest budget areas in Oregon.
Yep.
Do you feel that the federal government is doing enough for education?
Well, education is actually not in the U.S. Constitution. I carry around a U.S. Constitution myself when I'm out in the trail, as well as just personally. Mine's a little bit worn. The cover's kind of coming off. It's my original one. A lot of people over the years have actually sent me constitutions in the mail saying, Mark, you have a new one. But the point is, education is actually not in the federal constitution. So in terms of answering your question most directly, it can't be privatized fully, but it can be localized. I'm actually in favor of localized education. In terms of local control of education, local school boards making decisions that for students that are the most relatable and the most they're closest to in terms of making those decisions regarding their education. I actually support school vouchers and homeschooling as well, okay. Because ultimately a parent is the one that's in charge of their child's education.
Okay. We have a big partisan divide in this country. Mm-hmm. And there are extremes on all sides. Mm-hmm. If elected, how would you go about dealing with that extreme divide and moving the country forward?
I think what we have to do is actually find things that we have in common. I mean, there's several things that we have different, not necessarily you and I, but I mean, there's several things that are partisan and that people are very, very staunch about. You have the far left, the liberals and progressives, and you have the rights and the conservatives and the constitutionalists. But the point is, we have to find things that are in common. I actually have experience doing that in my last race. I won the May 2016 primary, and I was running statewide, and there's different issues for different areas in our beautiful state. And so I talked to conservatives, I talked to Republicans, I talked to Democrats, mm-hmm. I even talked to some Bernie supporters at the time. And the thing is, you have to find things in common. Like, for example, the checkbook issue. Mm-hmm. My family and I, we balance our checkbook, and I think the federal government should have to do the same. I'm in favor of a balanced budget amendment. When it comes down to the checkbook, yeah, whether you're a conservative on the right, or whether you're a progressive or a Bernie supporter on the left, you still got to balance the checkbook, you still got to pay for stuff. So in order to kind of bridge that gulf or bridge that partisan divide, yes, I am a Republican, yes, I am a conservative, but I'm willing to listen empathetically. I'm willing to listen to people, my fellow Oregonians. Whether I agree with them or not, I'm still going to listen to them. Okay. And I'm still going to try to find things in common with them that we can work together on.
Okay. We have run out of time, but it's been wonderful talking with you. Thank you.
Sounds good. And did you want me to give my website or anything?
Certainly.
My website is at callahanfororegon.com. That's C-A-L-L-A-H-A-N LLAHANFOROREGON.com.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.